more mathematical introduction to his work and the topic of today's colloquium. So Luigi belongs to this great Italian school of analysis of De Giorgi, I'm told, has led this school for many years, and he has been at full professor of mathematical analysis at Scuola Normale Superiore of Pisa, and he has been nominated, as I learned, director of the Scuola Normale Superiore. ICTP has a long-standing relationship with Scuola Normale Superiore, which culminated in signing an agreement for a number of joint research collaborations in mathematics and physics. Also, Professor Ambrosio has given various lectures on optimal transport and Monge-Ampere equations. We are sure that this fruitful collaboration will continue and will be enhanced in the future while he is the director. So he has received many accolades. I will just list a few. So he has been a visiting scientist at many major institutions like MIT, at Max Planck Institute, ETH, École Normale. He received the Riemann Prize of the Riemann International Mathematics School in 2022, the Balzan Prize for the achievements in the theory of partial differential equations in 2019, and the Blaise Pascal Medal of the European Academy of Sciences in 2019, and the gold medal for achievements in mathematics awarded by the National Academy of Sciences of Italy. And of course, he has been invited as the plenary speaker at the International Congress of Mathematics, which as all of you know, is an honor. He will be talking about a very interesting topic, but maybe I will leave this to Claudio to elaborate upon, but before that, I will invite Professor Andrea Romanino to say a few words.
Thank you, Atish. This is just to say that it's a great pleasure to welcome Professor Ambrosio, who's a well-known scientist and director. Had the privilege to meet the director most often, so I'm really looking forward to listen to the scientist today. I'm glad to see a significant part of the Trieste mathematics community, and not only the mathematics one, which has several different strong ties with the PISA one. And so thanks to ICTP for gathering us together here and hosting this event.
Just in joining me to welcome Professor Ambrosio, I just always make a point that, I mean, important recognitions come after a good theorem. So in this case, my role is to try at least with few slogans. I mean, Professor Ambrosio, of course, has been the recipient of hugely important recognitions in the mathematical community, but just in three slogans, I mean, why? I mean, so since I was a student almost, I mean, I came across his work, and I mean, he with his collaborators and his students, he has brought mathematical analysis to an even higher level than was before, and especially in connecting it with now I would say almost all branches of mathematics in a much, much deeper way. So the keywords of his work are, I mean, he wrote probably the book, actually, together with Nicola and Nicola Gigli at SISSA and Savare about gradient flows in metric space. I think if there was probably, maybe, I don't know if he would agree, but I mean, a unifying theme is to take actually very classical problems and bring them at the level of an extremely refinement of regularity, so to drop from the classical picture to the modern one, regularity issues, which is not just a game per se. So this, for certainly, I have to mention gradient flows for sure, which is a topic that actually became a huge. So he brought together, as I said, with many collaborators, but I mean, the study of gradient flows in metric spaces, probability measures, and geometric measure theory to an even deeper level, especially study, I mean, for me, there is one piece of work which is still certainly contains some treasures that geometers will still have to dig out properly, which is the study of currents in Banach spaces. I mean, currents, very classical object in mathematics, but typically you study them on a manifold or on a smooth manifold and so on. Ambrosio's work brought this thing to a completely new level, I mean, completely unimaginable before these works. And as I said, I mean, thinking of differential geometry, which is my subject, I'm sure there is still a lot of understanding to be done on that side. Also, even other classical problems like the famous isoperimetric inequality is probably one of the most famous mathematical theorems in the history of mathematics. But again, thanks to his work and the work of his collaborators, he has opened up completely new lines of research in terms of, again, asking these questions in Banach spaces, in probability measure spaces, in general metric spaces, and so on. So for all this reason, I think he has been, I mean, I could go on. I mean, there is a general theme also. Another general theme is the connection with optimal transport and connecting with various PDEs type of equations. PDE's equations in the which are famous by themselves, but now there is a kind of, again, a unifying theme thanks to his work. So these are, as I said, in 30 seconds, some of the reasons why he is recognized as one of the leading mathematicians in the world. And so we are. So I think today I was actually asked to say a few words about today. The truth, I mean, let me confess it openly, I don't know. I'm eager to learn. I suspect it's going to be, and I gave a quick look to the slides before, so I suspect it's going to be another opening up to another extremely exciting side of the story of connecting analysis with now themes coming from machine learning and also, again, classical problems about putting sparse and random points in a place where, I mean, essentially, it's all about minimizing an energy, which is a theme, of course, very dear also to our physics colleagues. But now we will see it appearing in a very different and probably less usual approach. So thank you very much for accepting our invitation, and it's all yours.
Okay, so first of all, thank you very much for the invitation. Of course, I am honored to be here for this joint SISSA ICTP colloquium, also on the occasion also the Ramanujan Prize awarded to Professor Fall. And I'm going to mention in my talk, maybe I move here, some problems in calculus of variation which have a geometric character, which are motivated, as we will see, by some, let's say, more practical problems related to the theory, which is, of course, a theory still in the infancy from many points of view of machine learning. In fact, I came to this problem thanks to a conversation with Michael Unser, who is professor at EPFL in Lausanne, which is a specialist in this topic. So let me start to give you a plan of my talk. We start with some general motivation, and then we enter a little bit into the mathematical side of the theory. Of course, I had to introduce some function spaces, which are maybe familiar to some of you, where we try to study this problem in an infinite dimensional setting. Then I will mention kind of variational problem, which is the kind of problem which is analyzed in the machine learning community. And then I will come really to the, maybe to the main part, the more geometric part of my lecture. I will tell you about extreme exposed points and this analysis that we have been doing of the so-called class of CPWL functions. This is an acronym for continuous piecewise linear functions. Okay, so, this comes from two papers I wrote with different collaborators last year and more recently this year. One of the co-authors is also Camillo Brena, which, by the way, is a former student also at SISSA, in Trieste and in SISSA. And S.Aziznejad and M.Unser is a PhD student at PFL. More on the mathematical side, there is this paper by Michael Unser, more on the applied side of the theory. If you want to go really more on the mathematical side, if you are interested more on the purely mathematical side, there are these papers that I will mention by Bredies and Carioni, which appeared on calculus of variation and PDE, and also this paper by Boyer, Chambol, Castro, Duval, and Gournay, which appeared on the SIOM Journal of Optimization. Again, maybe if you're interested on this topic of using this kind of energy, I will mention the Hessian shot and total variation as a regularization term. You may have a look also to this paper. Okay, so let me start with a very informal introduction. So what we mean by sparsity? In the classical theory, which is based on Fourier series, sparsity means that you may have problems where, let's say, only very few coefficients in a broad sense are relevant, right? And when this happens, when you do the Fourier expansion and only very few coefficients are relevant, you mean that there is this notion of sparsity. Of course, whenever you have a sparsity, this is very important for compression because this means that you can use only those coefficients to reconstruct the signal. More recently, a kind of analogy with this problem, which is typically of the theory of signals, appeared also in calculus of variation, in particular in the two papers I mentioned to you. The authors consider this kind of energy, where F, as I will explain later on, is the usual discrepancy term, for instance, in the applications to machine learning, and phi is a regularization term. And what is important is that they were able to prove by convex analysis tools that, you can find a minimizer. So minimizer can be represented as a special representation. Think, for instance, up to a normalization that phi of u bar, where u bar is a minimizer, is equal to 1. So this is not restrictive up to a normalization. So you may think that this is a convex combination, right? And what are the ui? The ui are, here I'm repeating this formula, right? What are the ui, the coefficients in this kind of convex combination, are extreme points for the unit ball of this energy, right? So it comes here, the geometric problem of trying to study the extreme points of the energy phi. What is the connection with machine learning? The connection with machine learning can be explained in this term, in these terms. Well, first of all, the typical form of a machine learning problem when you try to train the network is this. So you design, first of all, you design the network. So you specify a class of functions which you want to try to reproduce. And in this class of functions, you want to optimize, right? This function depends on a free parameter theta. And then you minimize, with respect to this free parameter, a kind of this is a kind of discrepancy terms with respect to the data you have. And lambda is a kind of tuning parameter between the discrepancy term and the regularization term phi. So what happens is that, of course, these problems have been well studied in the classical theory. But in the classical theory, typically the dependence of u on theta is linear. So this is the so-called the theory based on kernel methods. And for instance, H could be a kind of Gaussian kernel. But in terms of performance, at least empirically, now we know that this approach has been outpowered by the nonlinear version. For instance, the deep neural networks. So essentially, the most simple version of a deep neural network consists on a number of layers, L. And then the parameters in this problem in which you want to minimize corresponds basically to L affine functions, right? Where BL, say, let's say W1, WL are matrices and B1, BL are potentially drift vectors. So you are basically describing L affine functions. And you do the composition of these affine functions modulo. Then, of course, in this case, you will simply get a linear function. But what you're doing really in this case is to compose modulo the so-called activating function. So there is a nonlinearity here. And the typical form of the nonlinearity used in the application is the positive part. So you apply the positive part to all components of this vector. And then you iterate all these operations. Right? And so what can we say? Well, in this class, in this kind of parametric class of functions, sorry, maybe I go a little behind. In this parametric class of functions, you have to single out what is the most natural class of functions to deal with. And it is clear that, for instance, a natural class is the class of continuous piecewise linear functions, because this class is invariant under all these operations, truncation, so multiplication by the activation function, translation, multiplication by a matrix, and so on. And actually, this is true. It is true in a strong sense, because there is a relatively recent paper, 2016, which shows that actually any piecewise linear functions can be generated in this way, provided you have a sufficiently large number of layers. Of course, the more your piecewise constant, piecewise affine function is complex, the more layers you need. This is intuitive. Also, here comes another analogy. In the classical Fourier theory, it is known that sparsity is produced adding an L1 regularization. And so Unser and collaborator proposed as a regularization. Of course, you should take into account a regularization which is compatible with the class of piecewise affine functions. And the regularization that they suggested, that I will explain in the next slides, is the space of functions with bounded Hessian and the total variation of the second derivative as regularization. What is in this kind of measure theoretic framework, the analogous of sparsity, is that the derivative is concentrated. And in fact, if you think to a piecewise affine function, the second derivative in the sense of distribution is precisely concentrated on the edges which appear. Of course, in the simplest scenario of the one-dimensional case where you have the so-called splines, of course, the second derivative will be concentrated at single points. The second derivative, of course, in the sense of distributions. Okay, so now let me enter a little bit into the mathematical part of my talk. So first of all, we need the definition of the Sobolev space, W1P, which is the space of all functions in LP. So we whose peak power is integrable, with the property that the derivative in the sense of distribution is still representable by a function in LP. These are by now classical spaces, which are called Sobolev spaces. In formulas, you ask this integration by parts, where, of course, du over dxi is not, in general, the classical derivative, but it is the function for which the integration by parts formula works. And if there is such a function, it is unique. And of course, it is consistent with the classical, the smooth case. Of course, you can try to iterate this procedure, because like in the theory of distributions, you can differentiate infinitely many times. And so you can iterate this and define the space of functions whose derivatives up to, in the sense of distributions, up to the order k are in LP. But in our case, it is sufficient for us to stop at the second derivatives. But our second derivatives, just look at this example, will not be functions but measures. Okay? And so we come to the next definition. Which are the functions whose distributional derivative is a measure? Is the space BV, a space very much studied by the Italian school since the work of the Giorgi Cacioppoli and so on. And so again, you ask an integration by parts formula here, where in the right-hand side, you don't have a function, but you have a measure. And also, here I gave the definition for a vector-valued function. So this is true also for the components uj, where j, let's say, is between 1 and m. So we have m components. And for each of the components, we have for each of the partial derivatives of the components, we have a measure. Okay, so this is the frame. So let me just say a few words for those who are not experts about what we know about the distributional derivative. Well, in general, we can split this derivative into three parts, which are called absolutely continuous, jump, and Cantor part. So the absolutely continuous part is the part absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure, so the one for which you have a density. The density is typically denoted by nabla u, because indeed one can show that it is the differential of u in a suitable sense. Then there is the jump part. The jump part is concentrated on the discontinuities of u, and think also to the higher dimensional example. Let's say that you have, let's say you have at the top of a roof. Then, of course, in this case, the distributional derivative of this function is concentrated on this line, and the derivative corresponds is proportional to the difference between the values of the jumps from one side to the other, right? Come? No, no, for the moment I'm speaking about... this is already for the second order. So let me just do the first order version. Thank you. So let's say that you have a function which is jumping along a set. You have a discontinuity. Let's say you have limit on both sides, which I will denote by u plus and u minus. You have the normal, which are the objects which appear over there. And these objects give you the so-called jump part of the derivative, which, as you see, is a tensor product. So the first factor is a vector in Rm, and the second factor is a vector in Rn. And then there is a more mysterious part, which we call a Cantor part of derivative. I say it is mysterious because in some sense it can't be related to the pointwise behavior of the function, less to do with the differential in a suitable sense, while the jump part, you can recognize it because it has to do with the jumps of the function. The Cantor part is more mysterious. It's more mysterious. And why it is called the Cantor, because there is the famous example of a Cantor Vitali function, which is also called the Davis staircase. It is the example of a function whose derivative is zero almost everywhere. So in some sense, this graph is flat almost everywhere, but the function is continuous. And so you have neither this part of the derivative, because the derivative in the pointwise sense is zero. You don't have this part of the derivative because the function is continuous, no jump, but still you have a derivative because you go from zero to one. And so all the derivative in this case is Cantor part of the derivative. And of course, when we are going to consider later on the class of continuous piecewise linear functions, only the jump part will be relevant, right? Because in this case, only the gradient jumps along hypersurfaces. Nevertheless, it is important in some sense to place our problem for geometric reasons, as we see, in the full setting, and so to consider potentially all the other parts of the derivative. This is necessary in some sense to single out the piecewise linear functions as special ones. Okay. Okay, and now it comes to my space BH, the space which was proposed, the space, by the way, was already well known in the theory of elasticity, in calculus of variation in the theory of elasticity, but in some sense has been rediscovered in the machine learning community, which is the space of functions with bounded Hessian. So you might consider the space of functions which have a derivative in L1, whose gradient, let's say, whose all components of the gradient, du over dxi, all these functions are BB. And then there are a few results about integrability, in particular, this space has been studied in the context also of elasticity by a French researcher, Demangel. For instance, he proved that in dimension two, this space embeds into the space of continuous function. But maybe these are more technical things, and which I leave only for those who are more interested to the mathematical part. So now let me start, go again instead to the choice of the energy, the regularizing term in the variational problem. So what you can do is typically whenever you have a vector valued measure, so here, so I'm denoting by d2u, so this is a kind of a symmetric matrix of measures, which is the derivative along the j direction of du over dxj. By the symmetry of distributional derivatives, this is symmetric. So this is a vector-valued measure. And what it typically you can do is to write this vector-valued measure as hu times a scalar measure, which is called the total variation. And HU is a symmetric, and let's say with norm equal one. In some sense, HU gives you the orientation in a suitable sense, in the vector value sense of this second derivative. And there is a deep theorem proved by Giovanni Alberti, which applies also, it is deep because it applies also to the Cantor part of the derivative, showing that HU is a rank one matrix. So in some sense, it is more alike to the jump part than to the absolutely continuous part. And this, of course, will be an important information for us. And so combining rank one with symmetry, eventually you can prove that for the singular part of the derivative, hij, h is a tensor product of a vector by itself. And now you can decide what is your favorite semi-norm matrices, or if you like, only on symmetric matrices, and define your energy in this way. Right? You weight according to your favorite semi-norm, hu, and then you integrate. We will see that it was already observed by in the applied community that the most relevant choice of the energy of the norm is the so-called Schatten norm, so where you just sum the modulus of the eigenvalues. Of course, there is also the more traditional Euclidean norm. And so let me denote in the rest of my talk by phi s and phi e the two energies that you can build putting here either the Schatten norm or the Euclidean norm, which will correspond to taking the square root of the sum of squares. Okay, so this is also a small remark that will play a role later on. These energies behave well with respect to many operations. In particular, we will see also by convolution, but in particular, they behave well also under symmetrization. So if you take a function u and you symmetrize it, meaning that you take the mean value of u, maybe the most legible formula is this one. You take the mean value of u on the sphere with the radius modulus of x, then getting essentially a function of one variable, a radial function, then this energy, any of these energies decreases. And then a typical variational problem which is studied in the applied community is this. You minimize the discrepancy term, as I said, tuned by with respect to phi by this parameter lambda, plus my phi energy. And then there come analytic questions which are related to the embedding of these spaces inside continuous functions. So one can prove that for n larger than 3, actually, this problem is not well posed, in general. On the other hand, in the case n equal 1, the problem is well posed if you consider functions just of one variable. And indeed, in this case, what Unser and collaborators did was to compute minimizers explicitly and prove that exactly minimizers are splines, are one-dimensional curves like those I wrote over there. Then there is the critical case, which we studied in the second paper with Conti and Brena. In this case, this is really the critical dimension because there are kind of concentration effects of the Hessian. One has to analyze them very carefully. Anyhow, maybe this part will be more relevant for those of you who work already in calculus of variation. So we'll go about this more quickly. Actually, what we can prove, also because the assumption n equal 2, I would say, is not particularly realistic for applications to machine learning. It's just a more mathematical question. Anyhow, in dimension 2, one can prove that this problem has a solution where you put here the Schatten norm for lambda sufficiently small. Actually, if q equal 1, of course, everything depends on the power q that you put here. If you put here q equal 1, actually, this is true. You have minimizer for any value of lambda. As I said, in this problem, everything is related to the analysis of concentration of fats of the Hessian along minimizing sequences. And so one has to study this capacitary problem. And in the analysis of this capacitary problem, so you try to minimize the energy among all functions which are equal to one at the origin and which have compact support. And the constant 4 pi emerges really from the analysis of this problem. But I think this is more not so surprising. So let me go instead to the geometric part.
Yes. Can I ask you, what is F? I mean, what does F has to say?
F are the data, F are the data in your problem. So you are given, it should be U, sorry, F is U, is a typo.
Ah, okay.
It's a U, obviously it's U. It's lambda U of xi minus yi. Let me check if there was also before the same error. Yeah, in fact, yeah, there was U. Okay, thank you. Okay, so instead, let me go instead to the more geometric part of my talk, which is, I think, the one more interesting. So let me remind to you what is the definition of extreme point and exposed point. The definition of extreme point in convex analysis is a purely geometric definition. So let's say that you are in a vector space, and you have a subset S of your vector space, and you say that a point, a vector V, is extreme point if you can't write it as a convex combination of distinct points, V1, V2 in S, for instance. Of course, in this case, so for instance, for a circle, of course, all points are extreme points. For a square, the corners are the extreme points, and so on. There is also another interesting notion, which is the notion of exposed point. Exposed point, which uses a little bit of topology. So if you have a topology, you may say that a point is exposed if it is the unique minimizer for some continuous linear function. What are the basic facts about these two notions? Well known since, since 1950. First of all, in a Hausdorff topological vector space, a compact convex set can be generated by the extreme points. Generated means that if you take the convex combinations and you take the closure, you recover all the set. Of course, if you are in finite dimensions, you don't need to take the closure. This is Caro-Teodori theorem. And also, there is a clear implication between exposed and extreme. Exposed points, which are the unique minimizers, are clearly extreme. But in general, the two concepts do not coincide. Think, for instance, to this picture, a kind of stadium. So, for instance, this point is a point which is clearly extreme, but it is not exposed. There is no way to make this point a unique minimizer for some linear function, right? Moreover, however, still there are plenty of exposed points, even if in principle they are less than the extreme points. They are dense in the class of extreme points. And so still you have the Krein-Milman theorem. You can write the Krein-Milman theorem using exposed points. Okay, so as I said at the beginning of my lecture, the main point is to try to understand what are the extreme points of the unit ball for my phi energy. This is a second-order problem, so let me, for the sake of illustration, tell you what we know about the first-order problem. The first-order problem is basically well-known. Let's say it's part of the folklore on this subject. So let me say, let us look first at this problem. We consider all BV functions, so just one derivative. We take the BV functions modulo constants, right? In this way, the term du becomes not only a semi-normal, but a norm. And you try to understand what are the extreme points of this kind of ball computed with the total variation. Well, in this case, the answer is pretty well known. One can prove that u is extremal if and only if, well, first of all, the total variation has to be equal to 1. This is pretty clear. You are not in the interior of the ball, right? Not only, but u has also to be a constant multiple of a characteristic function. So c times the characteristic function on some set e, and moreover, the set e is connected, not really in the topological sense, but in a measure theoretic sense that I'm going to tell you. So how the proof works? So the proof arises trying to make reasonable decompositions of u. And well, first of all, it is clear, as I said, that the total variation of u has to be equal to 1. So this is a necessary condition. Then you try to do the most natural splitting of your function. You truncate at some level L, and you write U2, which is the positive part of U minus L. In this way, we have a natural decomposition of U. One can compute this constant, which are the perimeters of the level set from 0 to L and the perimeters of the sublevel set from L to infinity. And the Poincaré formula, the Poincaré formula tells you that alpha plus beta is the total variation, so it is equal to 1. And so we are basically building in this way a convex combination, u equal alpha v1 plus beta v2. So if u is extremal, this means that this is should be a trivial convex combination. And so it should be that v1 should be equal to v2. But v1 and v2 are parallel to usgl and u minus l plus. And so this means that these two functions, whatever l, level l you choose, are proportional. And since the level is arbitrary, it is not difficult to prove out of this information that u is has basically only two levels. So let's say the empty level and the level E. Okay, so it is a characteristic function. And then it comes a deep result by Herbert Federer in geometric measure theory, which says that this is analogous to the theorems that you have in topology. Let's say any open set can be written as a disjoint union of connected components. In this measure theoretic setting, one can prove that any set with finite perimeter can be written as a countable union of indecomposable components. Decomposable means that you can write E as a disjoint union of sets in such a way that the perimeters add, right? And of course, if E were decomposable, if you were able to write E in this way, then again, you will be able to provide a non-trivial decomposition of U. And so E has to be undecomposable. So this problem is pretty well understood for one derivative. What I'm going to tell you is what we have been able to prove for the second order problem. So again, we take a connected open set and we consider all functions which are in BH, but I will note BH star, again, modulo affine functions, because affine functions are not seen by my energy, by my second order energy phi. And in this way, modulo affine functions, again, phi becomes a norm. And we would like to understand what are the extreme points of S. As I said, the one-dimensional case has been studied, is not particularly difficult, and one can prove it's not particularly hard that all the extreme points are piecewise affine, piecewise linear, are the so-called splines. And what are the natural candidates in higher dimension, of course, are the piecewise linear functions. What do we expect about this problem? Well, we expect this problem to be more rigid compared to the first order problem, right? As usual, because the second derivative is more rigid than the first one. For instance, it is symmetric, just to give you one extra information. And also, as we will see, the choice of the norm will be particularly relevant. And so, what are the questions that we try to address? Can we characterize CPWL functions among those which are extreme? Well, this can be done. Basically, if you take a piecewise affine functions, you may find the conditions, in some sense, of the support of the derivative, which tell you kind of really a connectedness conditions, which tell you that this piecewise affine function is extreme. Actually, this is not yet clear for the more restrictive notion of exposed. But the more delicate question, which was really raised by Unser and collaborators, is whether can we say that all the extreme functions, like in dimension one, are piecewise linear or not? Of course, a positive answer would be very good, because it will tell you again, in terms of this convex representation, that any function can be represented as a convex representation of piecewise linear function. Actually, we found that the answer is no. It is not true. And for instance, if you take this radial function, let's say a kind of truncated cone, you can rotate maybe this picture along this vertical axis, all these functions are extremal. The proof is not obvious. It has to use all the structure, as I told you, of the distributional derivative. Because in principle, you have to consider candidates which are not piecewise linear. So you need all the information on the second derivative on any of any BH function. And so the answer is negative. Actually, it will be interesting to know, we still don't know, whether the truncated cone are not only extreme, but also exposed. That's an interesting question. Anyhow, well, we have a negative result, but we may try to recover a little bit of from this negative result, trying to prove at least that the CPWL functions are dense in the class of extreme functions. In this way, we can still recover. Sì.
So Schatter is the sum of the modulus of the eigenvalues, right?
Yes.
Okay, and P, so for the P equal 2 version of Schatter would be the Euclidean norm.
For p equal 2, yeah, for p equal 2. Otherwise, you take the sum of the p powers to the power 1 over p, yeah.
So even for the Euclidean case, these cones are extreme in particular?
Yeah, they are extreme for all the p, for the p. Well, we are going to see, actually, that the question that we're trying to recover, so the question, at least you would like to know to have the density. For this, it is really essential to have p equal 1. And so this motivates, in some sense, even more the reason why in the applied literature they really are convinced about the use of the Schatter norm the one with p equal 1, I mean. Okay, so so my next question is, well, we don't know, we know that they are not, there are functions which are extremal and are not piecewise linear, but can we approximate them in an efficient way? And this is my next question. See how much time? Yeah, I still have some time. So the question is, are these functions dense in energy with respect to phi s? Density in energy, of course, remember here we are considering really my geometric problem. So I don't need just a density in LP topology, which will be trivial. I need the so-called density in energy, meaning that I want to approximate, let's say, in L1, but in such a way that the energies are convergent. Phi s of UH converges to phi s of U. And then up to a normalization, you could say if phi s of U is equal to 1, so you are on the sphere, you want the approximating CPWL function to be on the sphere as well, right? It's an approximation in energy. In fact, yeah, by scaling, you can assume this. And well, this is more for the expert. All these energies are lower semi-continuous, so what is crucial here is to get the Linsup energy, the Linsup inequality. And actually, it is important to notice that this is not a question about, let's say, no-smooth functions or BV functions, because you can immediately reduce your question to smooth functions. If you're able to do this for a smooth target function U, you are able to do this for any function U, because by convolution, any of this phi energy decreases by convolution. Why? Because these phi energies are convex, a convolution is a mean value of translates, and so it decreases under convolution. So basically, we could rephrase the question is that given U, not in BH, but in infinity, can we find an approximation in such a way that the energy converges? And of course, this is maybe again more for the experts. If we knew that for the Euclidean norm the answer is positive, then it will be true for any phi energy. But actually, as I said before, the choice of the energy for this question is relevant. And the reason, maybe I go about this more quickly, but maybe the expert can ask to me the slides. The reason is that, first of all, the two energies coincide, the Schatten and the Euclidean one, let's say on CPWL functions, because on these functions you have only the jump part of the energy, and then they coincide. On the other hand, they do not coincide, let's say, when, for instance, you are just your target function is just a quadratic function. So in this case, you have the strict inequality. And so combining this strict inequality with an argument by contradiction, you can prove that if you have a positive answer for phi, then you have a positive answer for all the other ones, and so this is not possible. So for phi, the answer is no. It is not possible to do the approximation. Okay. And so actually, we got our results in different steps. Maybe first I tell you what is the most elementary and classical steps. So this is not particularly difficult to be proved, that you can get the Linsup inequality by a more or less standard approximation, but you get the Linsup inequality up to a multiplicative factor which depends on n. And so this result, of course, is not optimal. Well, this not optimal result can be obtained by any reasonable interpolation. You do a Lagrange interpolation, whatever reasonable interpolation you do, using essentially the Poincaré inequality in the single simplexes of the composition gives you this inequality. But of course, and maybe this is clear to the experts in gamma convergence in the audience, if you want to get the sharp approximation, you need in some sense to adapt your frame to the local behavior of the function. Assume also, as I said, that your target function is completely smooth. But of course, the Hessian matrix of U will be diagonal in frames which change from place to place. And so you have to adapt your frame to the local behavior of the function. And this is not so obvious because if you just change your frame in a trivial way, typically the geometry of the simplexes degenerate. So this is very well known in numerical analysis that when you have triangulations with very small angles, the constants that you get in the embedding degenerate, become out of control. So you have to adapt your triangulation, but keeping, in some sense, a control on the geometry of the simplexes. And eventually, we did this first in our paper in dimension two with Unser and Aziznejad. And maybe I just to close my lecture, I just give you some idea about the construction in dimension two. And then I will tell you about the higher dimensional case. So what is the idea of the construction? Well, these are the very first steps. Assume that you have your function. And first of all, you have made a division in many cubes. In your domain has been divided in many squares. Here we are in dimension two. And you know that in each of these squares, here I have singled only one of these squares, the Hessian of U is almost constant, and it is diagonal in this tilted direction, right? So the tilted direction is the one in which your Hessian is diagonal, and it is basically almost diagonal in any point inside this square. Of course, in a different square, you will have a completely different frame. You have to tilt in a quite different direction. Then, if you know that this is the good direction, so to speak, you can do the most obvious thing. You divide the square into triangles, and it gives you, let's say, optimal constants. The point is how to refine, in some sense, these triangulations near to the boundary, right? Because when you are going to consider the triangulations which will be done in a close square, you don't want to create jumps in the derivative. And in dimension two, we have been lucky because one can use a kind of self-similar construction. So assume that you have done already the trivial decomposition here, you continue in this region. And again, here in this rectangle, you do the trivial decomposition, and then you continue. And here there is some kind of self-similarity, which eventually tells you that all things you are doing are under control, and that there is a degeneration only near to the boundary, which can be eventually controlled. So this proof is using a kind of self-similar construction. Because you see, for instance, the triangle which appears at this level is similar to the one which appears here, and so things can be kept under control. More recently, with a much more complex construction, with the help of Sergio Conti in Bonn, we did the extension, not using self-similarity, but a kind of really of optimization. There is a kind of optimization technique for the frames. We were able to get the result in any dimension. As I said, why this result is relevant, at least from the theoretical point of view, because it tells you that all the extreme points of the unit ball are at least limits of CPWL extreme functions. And so even though we know that not all extreme points are CPWL, it is still true that we can recover, in some sense, the unit ball of this energy, by taking not only the convex hull, but this is typical also of infinite dimension, by the closed convex hull of extreme CPWL function. So in some sense, we recover, in some weaker sense, we recover the heuristics of Unser and the collaborators. And I think I can stop here. And thank you for the attention. And of course, I will be made available the slides if you are interested. Thank you.
So you mentioned before that if it were true, this density in energy with respect to the Euclidean norm, then by this argument, the convolution would be true for any other norm.
By Rechet,
yes. I wonder whether now that you have this result about this density in energy just for the Schatter norm, does it imply anything for some other special type of norm, maybe, I don't know, made with finite number, you know, norms such that it's a convex hull of a finite number of Vipulita.
Yeah, presumably. So, yeah, I will say in principle, keeping in mind also the proof of Reshetnyak theorem, I will say something which is less, so a norm with respect to which the Schatter norm sounds uniformly convex in some sense.
Yeah, exactly.
So relative uniform convexity, a relative strict convexity. Yeah, I think this is reasonable, yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Any other question?
You stated the density theorem for a cube, omega as a cube. Okay. Can it be clearly extended to polyhedral sets, or is there some other difficulty?
Well, I think the only difficulty we had, in fact, in the second paper with Conti, we consider all the slightly more general question, is, let's say, assume that you are able to extend your BH function from omega to a slightly larger domain without creating a second derivative on the boundary. Then you can make it.
Okay.
But it is not so clear to me whether there is a general result in this direction, right? For the cube, you do a reflection and you make it. But I would say for a general domain, not so clear. Anyhow, it's a kind of extension problem. Otherwise, if you don't want to do the extension, I think that you have to refine a little bit of our argument while going to the boundary. But since our proof was already quite complicated, we didn't want to introduce even this extra level of refinement. But I would say that, I will guess that for a C2 domain with more complication in the proof, even if you are not able to extend, it should be true. Yeah.
Other comments or questions? Well, I have to confess, I have a curiosity. I hope it's not too embarrassing. To, I'm a geometer, so I... but in passing from first order to second order,
yes.
In the first order problem, you were studying also, I mean, there was a data which were the xi, yi, and in fact you had the non-degeneracy condition to be imposed. Which first of all, my first question is, was there a connection between the fact that this non-degeneracy was actually that they don't lie on an affine space with the fact that you are actually studying non-piecewise linear or piecewise linear? I mean, is the linearity of the functions connected to the linearity of the non-degeneracy condition?
No, the non-degeneracy condition was really meant to exclude the trivial solution, because since phi, in all the variational problems I mentioned, phi was a second order. And so it's as if you already know that your data stay on a fine plane, you have the trivial solution for which phi equals zero, and you fit completely u by an affine function. So in that statement, I was saying, assuming that this is not true, then the problem is ill-posed. This is what I was going to say. But then dimension higher than three.
But then when you pass to second order, this data like the xi, yi, I mean, then the problem seemed to become different, at least. I didn't see about these extremes, points, and is there an analog problem like the one of first order that you...
No, but the variation problem was already second order. So the phi was already meant to be second order. And so okay. Maybe I will not got. The variational problem was already for this with two derivatives, not with one. I presented the first order version of the geometric problem of the extreme, or the characterization of the extreme points of the unit ball for the sake of illustration, right? Because if you consider the variation problem with the first order, the non-degeneracy is that the data are not constant, because only one derivative, right? Yeah.
Any other question? I think, if not, I have to invite everybody with a PhD to leave this room, and also those who don't have a PhD only for age reasons, I mean, because it's our tradition to leave the speaker for a few minutes with students to be able to discuss freely about life and mathematics, okay, and science.